not only Senator Chris Coons of Delaware, but also a very close friend and ally of President Biden. He's also a member of the Foreign Relations and Judiciary Committee, so we're going to talk about Sudan in a moment. But good morning. You're smiling. You're happy. You liked the video. But what about the skeptics? What about the polling over the weekend that shows that 51% of Democrats don't think he should run, and half of them are worried about how old he is? What do you say to them?
Poppy, great to be on with you. This is a great morning, and I am optimistic about the 2024 election. President Biden himself often says, "Don't compare me to the Almighty, compare me to the alternative." And I'll just briefly compare him to the alternative. President Trump talked about rebuilding our infrastructure. President Biden has actually gotten it done, passed a record bill to invest in rebuilding our infrastructure, a bipartisan bill. President Trump talked about cutting prescription drug prices. President Biden has actually gotten it done, signing into law a bill that will reduce prescription drug prices for millions of Americans. Across a dozen different topics, strengthening manufacturing, dealing with gun background checks, strengthening our position in the world, investing in community mental health, things that his predecessor merely talked about, President Biden working with bipartisan groups in the Congress has gotten done. We have the lowest unemployment in 50 years. The private sector's created a record 12 million jobs in his first 2 years as president. I think when folks look at President Biden and his strong record compared to the alternative, they will vote for him, and the polls show that and show that strongly.
How are you so sure the alternative is former President Trump? We don't even know what Governor Ron DeSantis is going to do.
That's right. We don't yet know how the Republican primaries will play out, but virtually every poll of the Republican primary electorate shows that former President Trump still has a commanding lead in their primaries. And frankly, President Trump in the campaign in 2016 showed himself to be a very capable, aggressive, agile, combative primary competitor. So I'll be very interested to see how Governor DeSantis does in the face of the withering personal attacks that we can expect. Well, look, I share the lack of enthusiasm of many Americans for a slugfest. I would only get to talk about the accomplishments of the last 2 years. But I think we are stronger abroad and safer and stronger at home. And I thought the introductory video featured not just President Biden's beautiful Catholic school penmanship, but the visuals that remind us of how much better off we are 2 years later.
I noticed the writing as well. But I remember after the midterms when you noted, you talked about, and Biden himself said in March of 2020, talking about carrying the torch forward for the next generation. If it is a Governor DeSantis, who, by the way, wasn't that far behind Trump in the polling over the weekend, right? He was a lot further ahead than other Republicans who are already in this race. Does that make it more difficult for this White House and Biden to be up against someone so much younger?
Well, Governor DeSantis has spent a lot of his time fighting culture wars, focusing on issues that fire up the far right base of the MAGA Republican Party, but that I'm not sure will succeed in helping him win over skeptical, independent, suburban voters. I'll remind you, cases in front of the Supreme Court about access to reproductive services just in the last few weeks will re-engage millions of Americans in the debate about how much individual liberty, how much freedom do they believe they deserve. There's a reason President Biden chose freedom as the theme of his introductory video for the 2024 re-elect. He has been focused on creating real opportunity for America's middle class and reminding us of the freedoms that are at risk and the importance of fighting to retain our freedoms both home and abroad.
Caitlin just did a really interesting interview with Governor Asa Hutchinson, who's running for the Republican ticket, about abortion and if these positions are strong ones for Republicans to run on. He said yes. Let's turn. You're on foreign relations. You've been warning about Sudan, writing about this issue for a long, long time. You're very concerned that what we see now could become a full-blown civil war in Sudan. I reread this op-ed you wrote, Senator, last year in Foreign Policy, and at that time you said, sanctions on the coup leaders and their networks will disrupt the military's revenue streams and their grip on power, creating an opening for the nation's nascent democracy to grow. Just yesterday on the show, we asked John Kirby at the White House about sanctions, and he said, we have a lot of tools at our disposal. We're working our way through right now. Should the Biden administration act now, put sanctions in place now?
Well, Poppy, I think this is one of the different tools that we should be presenting to the competing military leaders of Sudan, both General Burhan and General Hameti, who are currently tearing their country apart in a brutal and unjustified civil war. We have offered in the past sustained both development assistance and humanitarian assistance. Obviously, the other side of our toolkit is these targeted sanctions. I hope that the current ceasefire will hold and that along with our development partners, our security partners, other countries from Europe and the region, we will be able to finish evacuating those who want to leave the country. But frankly, more importantly, it's my hope that the determined work of our diplomats and some regional leaders will produce an enduring ceasefire and then allow a negotiated renewal of the movement towards a civilian government. If that doesn't happen, yes, I think sanctions are appropriate.
You do think sanctions in the near term?
In the near term, because frankly, they're squandering their chance at peace. Okay. And this is a country that deserves, because of so much civilian, civic leadership towards development and democracy, they deserve peace.
30 years of a brutal dictatorship. They were on the state sponsor of terrorism list. Just before you go, to your point about evacuations, because we do have this new reporting from our colleague Sam Kiley in Djibouti, that the U.S. is considering a plan to send U.S. troops to Port Sudan to help evacuate U.S. citizens. This has been a complaint of many U.S. citizens there, some who are dual nationals, some who are not, including one whose sister-in-law we heard from on the program yesterday. This woman is a teacher in Sudan. She's stuck there with her 18-month-old baby. So my question to you is, do you think the U.S. should do that, should send troops in the Port of Sudan and help those people get out?
Well, let's be clear. What you were describing was to Port Sudan, which is on the Red Sea, which is a long way from the active fighting in Khartoum.
Yes.
If we can safely facilitate the evacuation of civilian U.S. dual nationals, we should. But a large-scale military operation out of the center of Khartoum in the airport there, my assessment is that that's not safe at this moment.
Okay. We'll keep following because we also know two U.S. warships are being deployed toward the Port of Sudan right now. Senator Coons, I really appreciate you coming on CNN this morning. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. Caitlin.